With that, I invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy today's symposium. We've got a really great lineup for you, and thank you for being here.
Thanks again, Hannah. Now, very briefly, over the past year, as we've mentioned, we spent so many hours focusing on the havoc that can be wreaked upon humanity and even on our biosphere, right, when we throw things out of balance, to be candid. But now let's spend the next couple of hours or so in celebration of the microbes that keep our planet habitable for all life, including humans. So it's my pleasure to introduce our session on environmental microbiology. I'll be introducing the science speakers, and my colleague Julia will be introducing our featured scientist artists. So first, it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Arpita Bose, who's an associate professor of biology and earth and planetary sciences at Washington University in St. Louis. Dr. Bose's interests and talents are many, ranging from geomicrobiology and microbial physiology to biogeochemical cycling, gene regulation, and microbial respiration. But as of late, Dr. Bose has also been bringing her expertise to bear on microbial metabolism, or expertise in microbial metabolism, to bear on engineering microbial strains for sustainable biochemical and bioenergy production, as well as to tackle issues in bioremediation and biofouling. Dr. Bose has been the recipient of many honors and awards, including a Packard Fellowship in 2015, the Changing the Face of STEM Mentorship Award from L'Oreal and AAAS in 2017 and 19, and the Department of Defense Mentorship Awards in 19, 20, and 21. I'm very proud to say that Arpita Bose is also an alum of my lab here at Harvard, where she led groundbreaking work on microbes that breathe rust. I learned much from her, and it's wonderful to see her thriving at Washington University. So without any further ado, Dr. Bose, the screen is yours.
Thank you so much, Pete. I am so excited to give this seminar because most of what I present today is all stuff that started in your lab. So I'm going to share my screen. And hopefully everybody can see my slides. Can everyone see my slides?
Looks perfect. Thanks, Arpita.
Awesome. So I'm really excited to give this seminar today because so much of this started at Harvard, and it's like coming full circle for me. And like Pete said, that there's a lot going on and microorganisms are doing so much for us, and there's a happy side to it. And I hope that this can showcase the happier side of microorganisms. So I'm going to talk to you about work that I've done in the past 6 years or so, discovering and exploring the electric side of photosynthesis. But this is the first talk of the session, so I wanted to go big, and I wanted to ask some of you in the audience, what do you think life is? And I know that this might not be as interactive as I had hoped, but let's just dive in and think about this existential question. What is life? For me, boringly, life is made of carbon, and maybe some of you agree with me. I also know that life requires energy. But then it gets even more complicated. Life requires an electron donor, and it also requires an electron acceptor. And this movement of electrons from a donor to an acceptor and vice versa is what I think life is made of. And at least one person I know agrees with me. It's Avul Sentkiorgi. He's no longer with us, but he had won the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 1937 for the discovery of ascorbic acid, which we recognize as vitamin C, and also the reactions of the citric acid cycle. He also said that life is nothing but an electron looking for a place to rest. So now let's look at what we do. We think we are very exotic and we have very different diets, but actually turns out that we have a very specialized diet. For energy, we can only use chemical energy. For carbon and electron donors, we use food. We might think that we are omnivores or vegetarian, vegans, et cetera, but all of the food we eat is organic carbon, and it serves as a carbon source and our electron donor. As an electron acceptor, all we can use is just one thing, which is oxygen. So in the morning, maybe you ate some breakfast, I did, and I burnt that organic carbon in my breakfast, the electrons from that ended up on oxygen, reducing it to water. And that's how I made energy. And I'm very energetic giving this talk right now. But microorganisms are much more exotic with respect to their diets. And this, Pete, is a fish image of an ethane degrading consortium that was isolated essentially in Pete's lab, starting in Pete's lab. And this consortium is so unique, it can actually degrade a 2-carbon highly reduced molecule like ethane, something that we can never imagine ever consuming. So microorganisms have diverse diets. They can eat complex carbon, they can consume and use simple carbon molecules. For energy, they can not only use chemical energy, but they can also use light energy. In that way, they're like plants in some ways. And for electron donors, I would venture to say that they can use anything that can donate electrons. And that might be a little bit far-fetched for some people, but that's what I believe. And for an electron acceptor, again, I think they can use anything that can accept electrons. So to me, the true diversity of microorganisms comes from this ability to use different forms of carbon, different forms of energy, electron donors and acceptors. And diving into what I have been focusing on with something that started in Pete's lab was this really extraordinary ability of microorganisms to use solid materials, solid conductive substances like rust or proxies of these like poised electrodes as sources of electrons, as electron acceptors and donors. For about 30 years, we know that microorganisms that can degrade organic carbon, much like we do, and produce electrons, when we actually take these electrons and dump it on oxygen to make water, these organisms, however, can use rust and even poised electrodes, practically making electricity. And the mechanisms underlying these this process are known, and this process itself is called extracellular electron transfer. Now we know that this is one flavor of how microorganisms can interact with solid materials. And this is the reductive form of extracellular electron transfer. When I came to Pete's lab, I didn't really have a plan in mind, but I know that thanks to the efforts in his lab, I was able to recognize that it's possible that these substances that are solid can serve as sources of electrons, like electron donors for microorganisms. At that time, there was very little understood about this. In fact, people were mostly noticing these phenomena, this phenomenon in the environment. And there were very few organisms that were in pure culture that could do this. Since then, this entire concept where solid materials that are conductive can serve as electron donors has burgeoned into its own field in the past 6 years, 7 years or so. And this process is called extracellular electron uptake, where these solid materials can serve as electron donors for microbial metabolism. So why was I even thinking about all of this? I was thinking about this in the context of a very cool microbial metabolism that's called photoferrotrophy. Photoferrotrophy is the ability of microorganisms to use light. So I mentioned that microorganisms can use light much like plants as an energy source, and they can fix CO2 to biomass, but the electrons for this fixation reaction comes from something really exotic like soluble iron, depicted here as iron 2. And this metabolism happens in the photic zone. When microorganisms do this, they practically surround themselves in rust, and many of them get attached to these rust particles like goethite and eventually magnetite, and they actually sink to the bottom of ecosystems. So earlier their metabolism had to be focused in the photic zone, then they sink to the bottom in the aphotic zone, and they settle in the bottom like microbial mats that you might have seen if you go to some salt marsh. And why is photoferrotrophy so important? Many people believe that photoferrotrophy might have given rise to what are called the Precambrian Banded formations. And to just give you a sense of scale, I can't see myself, but this is like a little show and tell. This is a Banded formation from Australia. And you can see that there are layers of alternating iron oxides with black layers that are called chert or silica. And you can see that these structures are very exotic because they formed a very long time ago in the Precambrian period. And many scientists believe that photoferrotrophs might have led to the formation of these structures along with other processes. And believe it or not, this is the largest iron ore deposits we have. So this is why I got very interested in understanding photoferrotrophy. But thanks to my introduction to Pete's lab, I also understood that these microorganisms exist in extant ecosystems and that things might not be so simple for them. And I already knew that in the lab when I was growing them, these microorganisms would get surrounded by rust and most likely would sink to the bottom of any ecosystem. And then they would be spatially separated from their choice electron donor iron 2, as well as light, which is their energy source. But we understood that they're reductive EET capable organisms that can use, say, organic carbon that's being released from these same cells and other cells dying and releasing this organic carbon. So they can use this organic carbon as an electron and carbon source. They oxidize this to CO2, much like we do, and they transfer these electrons to solid or rust particles produced by, say, organisms like photoferrotrophs. So they establish a really nice iron cycle. So it all makes sense. You have photoferrotrophs that want to hang out in the photic zone. You have reductive EET capable organisms that can make this iron 2 available to them in the photic zone. It all kind of makes sense. But there's one problem. Reductive EET capable microorganisms don't want to hang out in the photic zone. They want to hang out in the aphotic zone where there's lower oxygen, and they tend to be in the almost in the bottom of ecosystems. So now this creates a problem. Photoferrotrophs want to hang out in the photic zone. They also require iron too, but reductive EET capable organisms want to hang out at the bottom. Now what? And so this is where this idea of perhaps a process like extracellular electron uptake became even more attractive to me as I was continuing my postdoc in Pete's lab, where it became apparent that if organisms like photoferrotrophs want to hang out in the photic zone, which is where their choice energy sources, but they don't have access to their choice electron donor, they can still have access to these electrons through this process of extracellular electron uptake if there's a conductive matrix around them, and these electrons can be taken up by these microorganisms. So they can continue to have access to these electrons to fix CO2 to biomass. So this was this idea that I had when I came to Pete's lab, but then how do I really go about answering this question? We were just scratching our heads trying to figure out if there are even organisms that can do this. And so this is where I think I got lucky, because I had started my postdoc in Diane Newman's lab, where I was working at MIT, while she was at MIT, and I was working with this really cool organism called Rhodopseudomonas palustris Taiwan, and it can do photoferrotrophy. So it uses the energy of light, hangs out in the photic zone, and fixes CO2 to biomass using electrons from iron 2. But I was growing this in the lab, so you'll start with, not rusty cultures. You'll inoculate them with this organism, and the bottle will become rusty within a few weeks. And practically, these organisms would surround themselves with iron oxides like you see right here. So I was seeing just in the lab that there was spatial separation between the microorganism and iron 2, which was their choice electron donor. So I knew that this organism faces the same challenge that I just outlined to you earlier in the talk. And when I moved to Pete's lab, he was going to the bottom of the ocean, bringing rocks and mud and whatnot, and bringing them to the lab. And with a lot of energetic grad students, we were putting together these bioelectrochemical systems and studying whether these the microorganisms in these rocks and mud could be used, could use solid materials as electron acceptors or donors. And we were using these bioelectrochemical systems where you had an anode or and a cathode. They were separated by a proton exchange membrane. And I knew that the cathode is where electron transfer would occur for an organism like Taiwan. So I thought that maybe if I inoculated microorganisms in the cathodic chamber and only provided light as the energy source, CO2 as the electron acceptor, perhaps an electron donor, the electron donor being this poised electrode, perhaps the only thing that could happen for the organism to grow is for it to do extracellular electron uptake from this poised cathode. And the potential that I used was exactly these minerals that these organisms produced. So it was an experiment that we tried with some other postdocs in the lab. We had no real expectation, but very quickly we saw that we were correct, that Rhodopseudomonas palustris Taiwan was able to accept electrons from these poised electrodes in the presence of light. And if we took light away, we lost 70% of this ability and only 30% of that activity remained. And in Pete's lab, this became a nice paper for me, and I started my lab at WashU using this idea. And since then, we've used Taiwan as an excellent model to study not only the molecular mechanisms of how electrons come in from soluble iron, as well as electrodes and rust, where these electrons go, because this is a photosynthetic system, it goes to the photosystem, and eventually how these electrons allow the organism to fix CO2 to biomass. And in the midst of it, we have had a couple of PhDs from the lab. So this Dinesh Gupta, now a PhD and a postdoc in UC Berkeley, and Dipti Nayak's lab, who's also from Harvard. And he was able to show, with the help of Bob Kranz and Molly Sutherland, the mechanism underlying how these electrons come into the cell. And so we got clues from an organism that's a reductive EET capable organism called Schwannella onidensis. It's a gram-negative organism, so it has a cytoplasmic membrane, a periplasm, and an outer membrane. And it uses this three-protein complex where you have a porin that holds together two decaheme cytochromes, one that sits in the periplasm and another that sits extracellularly. And electrons that are produced by, say, degrading organic carbon are passed from the cell through the periplasm, through this conduit to, say, iron oxides or rust to reduce them to iron two. We also knew from Diane Newman's lab that there's an operon called the bio-ABC operon that she had shown was important for iron oxidation, and that there were similarities between these two systems, where you had the porin, you had the periplasmic decaheme cytochrome, but you didn't have the extracellular outer membrane decaheme cytochrome. Instead, you had this high membrane, high potential iron sulfur cluster protein that might be important for bringing the electrons into the cell instead of pumping them out. And to really ask if to test whether this system might be important for extracellular electron uptake, we had to move away from the bioelectrochemical systems that we were using sort of in Pete's lab. And we had to make miniaturized versions of these bioelectrochemical systems. And this was work done with Mark Meacham at Mechanical Engineering at WashU and my postdoc, where we literally miniaturized these electrodes. And now we have microfabricated them into 96 well format, which is essentially a small little plate that can sit on a plate reader. And the way that this system differs from the bioelectrochemical systems I just described is that here you have the cathodic chamber and you have planktonic cells, as well as cells that are attached to the electrode. And so you have the contribution of both the plankton as well as the cells that are biofilm attached. However, in the bioelectrochemical cell or the microbec, we can actually attach the cells as biofilms. And because there's fluidic control, we can wash off the plankton. And the only contribution we see is from cells that are attached to the electrode, which is indium tin oxide in this case. And using this, we were able to show that indeed, the wild type is able to take up electrons. And here the gray bars show dark conditions, and you don't see any electron uptake in the dark, but you do see in under light that there's electron uptake, shown by the blue lines here, that the bio-ABC mutant and other mutants that we had made in this operon are absolutely not able to do extracellular electron uptake. And there's a mutant where a small portion of the bio-A protein is deleted, and that has a defect. And so using this bioelectrochemical system, we were able to show that indeed the bio-ABC system was absolutely essential for extracellular electron uptake. And now we know that we can use the bio-AB complex as a hook for environmental organisms. And there are at least two other environmental organisms that we're easily able to find in GenBank. And these are Rhodomicrobium udeparensae and Rhodomicrobium vanellii. And just the presence of the bio-ABC system in this showed us that we can actually predict that these organisms would be able to do iron oxidation. So here we are tracking iron over time. So these organisms have bio-ABC. Just like Taiwan, they're also able to do photoferritrophy. And just like Taiwan, they're also able to take up electrons from a poised electrode. And this got a graduate student, Eric Connors, in the lab very excited about studying these organisms because they have been implicated in banded iron formations, the same structures that I showed you here. So we kind of come full circle, going from not knowing anything about these structures and how they might have come about, looking at extant organisms and connecting the dots with Earth history. So microbes are super important. And now you can see that using Taiwan as a model, we have been able to show that the bio-ABC proteins are produced inside the cytosol of Taiwan. They're transported through the inner membrane to the periplasm. The bio-B protein gets inserted in the outer membrane. The bio-A protein is truncated. A 200 amino acid region is lost. It makes a complex with bio-B. And then with the help of bio-C, it actually takes electrons eventually to the energy heart of the energetic system in this organism. And this was work done with another graduate student who's the first graduate student to go to college and his family, Michael Guzman, who published his work in Nature Communications. And he was able to use the same microbac that I described to actually probe the photosynthetic system in this organism. And again, there were two other PhDs that were involved in this as well. And that's Michael Binkley and Andrea Stoica, who's in my lab with Marks as well. And so again, just as a reminder that in the microbec, we are looking at the response of only the cells that are attached to the electrode. And here, if you have a no cell control, you can see that there's no electron uptake. But if you have wild type Taiwan and you expose it to either dark or light conditions, you can easily within seconds track electron uptake happening in these microbec systems. And using that, we probe the photosynthetic electron transport chain of phototrophs like Rhodopsodomonas palustris. It's a complex system, and I don't want you to focus too much on what you see here, except the fact that if you were to track the energetic changes that were happening to the photosystem of this organism in response to light, you see light and this photosystem are friends. The moment light shines on this photosystem gets very energized because it has a molecule inside it. And then this highly energized electron wants to move back to the ground state. From basic physics, we understand that. And biology has come up with ways of sort of taking advantage of this electron drop. And it has inserted all these different proteins in the way. And these proteins can generate a proton motor force that allows the cell to make ATP. And we do exactly the same thing in our mitochondria. And here, using different kinds of chemical inhibition approaches, especially using antimycin in this example, where it inhibited one particular component of the photosystem called the cytochrome BC1 complex, we were able to show that if we actually inhibit the cytochrome BC1 complex, we are completely able to stop electron transfer from occurring, suggesting that the electrode, which is poised in this case at plus 100 millivolts, probably allows the electrons to enter at the BC1 complex. So we were able to do biophysical experiments using this system that we created. And we now know that the electrons come through the bio-ABC system in Taiwan, and they enter the photosystem at the level of BC1. And Michael also showed that these electrons can move even further to allow these organisms to do primary productivity. They're actually making biomass using these electrons from solid conductive materials. And so he actually was very brave, and he went about deleting a gene called Rubisco that's part of the Calvin-Benson-Bisham cycle. Rubisco is an absolutely essential gene, and Rhodopsodomonas palustris has two copies of it, Rubisco form 1, which is called CBBLS, and Rubisco form 2, which is called CBBM. And through many years of effort, he was actually able to delete these essential genes. And what he found was spectacular. What he found was the wild type was able to take up electrons over time, but the Rubisco form 1 CBBLS mutant had very little defect in electron uptake. The Rubisco form 2, which is CBBM, also didn't have a defect. But when he deleted both of these forms of Rubisco, he prevented carbon fixation from occurring using the Calvin-Benson-Basham cycle, and this organism could no longer take up electrons anymore. So in summary, what he showed was that Rubisco was essential for extracellular electron uptake, and that the inside of the cell is connected to the outside of the cell. If you don't allow the cell to fix CO2 through the CBB cycle by deleting Rubisco, it can no longer do extracellular electron uptake. And to me, this was remarkable that there's such a huge connection between what's happening inside a microorganism with what's happening outside. They're extremely smart creatures. But as someone who's passed through Pete's lab, there's no way I was satisfied with doing all this molecular work, genetic work, biophysical work. To me, none of this meant anything if it didn't matter ecologically. And thanks to my training in Pete's lab, I was able to move to Woods Hole as a teaching faculty the summer before I came to WashU. And together with students, we isolated organisms from this really cool ecosystem called Trunk River, which is an estuarine environment. And a fun fact is that it's very close to Albert St. Georgi's home. So I'm very connected, very attached to Woods Hole. And we were able to show that in these ecosystems, we can isolate photosynthetic organisms and that they can all do photoferrotrophy and they can all do extracellular electron uptake. And this work is going to come out soon in ISMI-J. And being in WashU, we're very close to the Mississippi River Valley, and we identified a little cool ecosystem called Ellis Island. And every year, twice a year, we go to this ecosystem, we sample this wetland ecosystem, and we have been able to isolate many, many photosynthetic organisms that also can do photoferrotrophy as well as extracellular electron uptake. So this process isn't just limited to Taiwan. You can find it everywhere. And we, over the course of 6 years, have focused on photoautotrophs that can do extracellular electron uptake. But here, Michael and Dinesh, together with me, reviewed that the field has come a long way, and it shows that extracellular electron uptake, this ability to use solid conductive substances as electron donors, is all over our planet. It happens in photic zones, in oxic zones, anoxic zones, in the deep sea. It's pretty spectacular that in a very short time, the community has shown that this process is so common. But why is this process so common? I think it brings us back to the same original idea that we had while I was in a postdoc in Pete's lab, where microorganisms face the separation from their choice electron donor all the time. It's happening in the test tube and when we are growing Rhodopseudomonas, but it's happening in the environment all the time. And the environment is extremely conductive. Not only does it have minerals, but it has other small molecules that make the environment very conductive. And as long as an organism has this ability to do extracellular electron uptake, it will be able to survive and perhaps even grow. And it can be spatially separated from its electron donor, but as long as it has this ability, it's fine and can hang out wherever it wants. And now we have been able to show that not only is it happening in wetlands like Woods Hole and Ellis Island, but that it's happening in our bodies as well. And we're looking at this phenomenon in human pathogens. And there are hypotheses that are being tested in my lab that maybe this process is important for the first eukaryotes that might have come across as well. And so without any further ado, I want to thank my lab. My lab has been spectacular, and we have created a very diverse ecosystem. And when Pete brought up racial inequities in every aspect of our lives across the globe, I have been fortunate that my lab has never felt any racial inequity. Look at my lab. We have people from all over the world. We have people all shades of shades, and we have gotten amazing support from the community to help build their careers and explore this really interesting phenomenon as well. And with that, I just wanted to say thank you for your time, and if you have any questions.
Thank you very much, Arpita. I have questions, but first, let's in the interest